from Memorial Stadium on the campus of the University of Illinois, welcome to IHSA State Championship Football. Hi, everybody. I'm Darryl Burnett. Yesterday, we crowned three state champs. Today, three more, beginning with Class 4A. As you can tell, it is cold. It is very, very wet. It is Illinois football in the month of November. Both teams coming in perfect, though, even though the weather isn't today. Joliet Catholic, 13-0. Metamora, also 13-0. The last two unbeaten teams left in the state. Well, while these teams have been pouring over last-minute preparations and getting poured on here today, both are rich in tradition, both have a lot at stake here, and both are going to be very, very wet before the day is through. For all the action, let's now kick it up top to Dave Bernhardt and Jack McInerney for all the play-by-play.
Thank you very much, Darryl. You take a look at today's ball game, how interesting it is. Out of the six championship games played here this weekend, this is the only game involving undefeated teams. And it's also the only game involving teams that met last year for the state championship. Of course, Joliet Catholic Academy, 48-13 winners over Metamora on this very field last year, Jack. And I know the Redbirds have a little bit different in mind this year.
Well, you know, last year, Dave, the Redbirds were just happy to be here. They really celebrated after their semifinal win. And they were happy to come to Champaign. This year, they're happy to be here, but they're here to win. It's a whole different attitude with the Metamora Redbirds this year.
As far as Joliet Catholic is concerned, eight state championships, that is a state record. Now, these two teams know each other very well. They know how to get from one location to the other to do their scouting. And there you see it, Joliet Catholic, of course, the suburbs of Chicago, Metamora, central Illinois. They had a little bit shorter trip to get down here to Champaign. But both teams, of course, have to win four games to get right here. And as you'd expect for Joliet Catholic Academy, one of the top seeds in 4A, undefeated on the season, they had an easy time for at least the first two, maybe three games. But Jack, that semifinal game against Pontiac was an adventure.
Well, you know, Pontiac probably set them up for this game. It's going to be an exciting game. 26 wins between the two teams. Somebody's going to go home a loser, but Pontiac helped Joliet Catholic get ready for this big game. And of course, Metamora has had a tough schedule, but they've also come through victorious. So it's going to be a real interesting ball game.
As far as Metamora is concerned, their toughest game did not come in the semifinal game. Their toughest game came in game number two. Peoria Richwoods had Metamora down by two touchdowns in that game, but champions are made of victories like that 42-35 win.
Well, you know, that really shows the character of a true state champion. Now, whether or not that will have any effect in today's ball game, we'll soon find out. But they came back, they had character, they showed the fact that they can come from behind. Last year, they weren't capable of doing that with Joliet Catholic. Joliet Catholic jumped on them in the second quarter, and they couldn't come back. But maybe that ball game will make a difference for them this year.
As far as Metamora is concerned, you saw they beat Bishop McNamara in that semifinal game. Bishop McNamara, one of the teams that have played in this championship game once in the last 5 years. Who was the other opponent for the last five? The Metamora Redbirds. Let's not keep them waiting any longer. It's been a long season. It culminates today. Let's go down the field and meet the starting lineups with our public address announcer, Jeff Fritzen.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, here are your starting lineups for the Class 4A State Championship game. First, from Joliet Catholic, head coach Dan Sharp. The Hilltoppers defense. At end, number 90, Mike Coloje. At tackle, number 77, Andrew Damiani. At tackle, number 52, Sean O'Connor. At end, number 99, Pat McShane. At linebacker, number 34, Ross Grossi. At linebacker, number 5, Joe Corrin. At linebacker, number 42, Ryan Lincoln. At linebacker, number 44, Ross Crampton. At defensive back, number 33, Anthony Jutras. At defensive back, number 4, Jake Jaworski. And at defensive back, number 14, Mike Pullman. And now your starters for Metamora, head coach Pat Ryan. The Redbirds offense, number 82, end Kyle Dentino. At tackle, number 76, Bob Kokendorfer. At guard, number 64, John Mischler. At center, number 55, Jared Fry. At guard, number 75, Chris Warwick. At tackle, number 56, Ryan Otto. And at end, number 94, Aaron Lyon. At quarterback, number 12, Joe Stamm. At wingback, number 2, Adam Schertz. At wingback, number 43, Nathan Ferguson. And at fullback, number 40, Rick Alvis.
They are wet and they are ready to go. And so are some of our key players in today's ball game. Of course, you're in Class 4A. You have Joliet Catholic Academy and you have a stud running back in the form of J.R. Zwardzinski.
Well, this kid is really something for a junior. He's got everything you want in a running back. He's 6'3", he's 215 pounds. He runs with speed, he's got great hands. And he's really the go-to guy for Joliet Catholic. He's also thrown a couple touchdown passes. Now here's the other guy, Pat McShane. Now this is the key right here, sacks 15. That tells you that he's got great mobility. He gets around the field, he can really run. He's going to Boston College on a full scholarship and he'll probably be a stand-up linebacker.
The quarterback they'll have to worry about, McShane, that's Joe Stamm. He returns after last year's championship game.
Well, you know, he's a veteran. He writes a note to all the starters before each ball game. He's a special kind of kid. He can do it all.
Bob Kokendorfer, a huge right tackle. He'll be a key factor as well, just a junior.
Well, 300 pounds, they're going to have to deal with him. And, of course, Rick Alvis, the running back, he's the key inside at fullback. He's got a lot of yards. He's a tough kid.
We are underway in the 4A state championship. Kickoff taken by Adam Schertz. He's got some room. Schertz across the 30 and tripped up at the 30-yard line. Only a tackle that time by Brad Hudetz. The kicker prevents that one from going a long ways. A 23-yard kickoff return nevertheless.
That gives them great field position, but it also gives them a lot of confidence on the first play.
Look at the size of this offensive line. It is huge. Lyon, Otto, Warwick, Fry, Mischler, and Kokendorfer throw in Dentino. Kokendorfer, that 300-pounder in the backfield. Of course, Joe Stamm, we talked about him. Now, Adam Schertz will have to pick up the slack for the loss of Luke Maurer. Rick Alvis, you're going to like him if you like the Mike Allstott type. They start from the 35. And they start with Alvis, and he'll be dumped for a loss. Joe Corrin with the tackle, back to the 34-yard line. That defensive unit for Joliet Catholic Academy only allowing about 73 yards per game on the ground this season. Their defensive front, look at the difference in sizes. You have Mike Coloje, 6'7", 280, and then Andrew Damiani at 5'7". McShane on the other side. Linebackers, always great linebackers. Two of them are sophomores, Crampton and Lincoln. You just saw Joe Corrin on the tackle. Rosie's Jaworski, Coleman, and Jutras. Kind of a patchwork sort of defensive secondary for the Hill. From the 34, they want Alvis again, and they will get him to about the 38-yard line.
Well, by formation here, they're trying to spread out Joliet Catholic. They went to a slot on one side and a split on the other. They're trying to spread out that secondary and those linebackers to create some seams in the middle.
Sean O'Connor, 6'4", 230-pounder senior with the tackle on the last play. And this is a situation that Joliet Catholic would like Metamora to be in. Third down and long.
Metamora doesn't like to throw the ball. They only threw 87 times in the regular season.
They will go to Ferguson. He's got a hold off right tackle. Ferguson has the first down across the 45.
That's their answer to the pass, Dave. The misdirection coming back. And they get those linebackers flowing in one direction. They come back with the counter.
Nathan Ferguson, just a sophomore. He took over for Jeremiah Lotz. Now, two of the key running backs for the Redbirds, Luke Maurer and Jeremiah Lotz, gone, replaced by Ferguson and Schertz. Taking advantage of the excellent kickoff return. It's a first down at the 48. Stamm with the option. Still loose. And I believe Alvis will have it. Wow.
That went from about an 8-yard loss. He had the perimeter. Had that pitch been successful, he was gone all the way. We're coming right down here, and you'll see, watch right out here. He's coming inside. If he pitches the ball here, there is nobody out here. That's 6 points. Right over here, on the outside, the corner came up inside on the quarterback, and they did not take the pitch man.
That's a loss of 10 on the play. We're back at the 38-yard line.
That could have been a big play and was a bad play for Metamora, as it turns out.
Stamm, the senior quarterback, he will keep it. He's got a huge hole across midfield. Joe Stamm is close to the first down. Mike Coleman prevented a possible six.
Well, they took the safety out of the middle by going to a slot. we'll take a look at the formations, and that's the big key. They're spreading out the inside linebackers. You can see right up in this area here, and they have a receiver down here. They're spreading out the linebackers and the safety to create that running lane up inside for the quarterback and the fullback. So by formation, they're doing a few things at Joliet Catholic that they're not used to at this point.
Stam averages about 10.8 yards per carry. He got 19. It's third and one. Elvis may not get there. Rick Elvis has been compared to Mike Alstott, formerly of Joliet Catholic, of course, now with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Elvis, you give it to him on third down in a yard.
Well, you certainly you'd give it to him, and the reason is he's been averaging 7 yards a carry, but they haven't been playing against Joliet Catholic all year.
These two lines, offensively and defensively, mammoth. And right now, the Metamora Redbirds need about a yard and a half, almost two, for a first down here on fourth down. Stam has the first down across the 40, brought down by Ross Crampton, the outside linebacker.
I like Coach Ryan's attitude. They're going to go after him and put it right on him. Now, what they're doing is they're coming off tackle. They're figuring Elvis is going to dive up inside. And so the linebackers are in tight. You can see right here where those linebackers came in here, and he comes out around the perimeter and seals up inside and picks up the first down. Good call, play call by Coach Ryan.
Nick Pinnaire will split out far to the right side. It will be a story if we see a number of passes today for Metamora. They stay on the ground. Stam with it, he's got more. To the 30, to the 25. 15, 10, dives. He's out at the two. Touchdown! They signal touchdown. 39-yard run for Joe Stam, and Metamora has drawn first blood. But a flag is down.
You're going to see the dive fake right up in here, and he comes out over here, and this is where you want to go. He drove the linebackers in with the dive fake to Elvis, and he gets at the perimeter. And he's gone. He's got great speed. He had over 1,300 yards rushing, but we're bringing it all back. It was all for naught.
Clipping on the offense.
A clipping penalty takes away a touchdown, and I guess, Jack, that explains the lack of a touchdown signal as the officials had the flag thrown at about the 25-yard line, wiping out a 39-yard touchdown run. That becomes our line of scrimmage. It's first and 10. It's like the play never happened.
Well, it'll be interesting, Dave, to reflect back on that particular play, maybe in two quarters or in the fourth quarter, the difference in momentum and confidence level of Metamora.
So on first and 10, Ferguson will try the right side. He'll get a couple to about the 36.
Another misdirection play. They're trying to keep those linebackers on their toes where they're going with Elvis, and they come back with the wing back in the other direction. You need to do this against a very aggressive Joliet Catholic defense.
Tackle was made by Ryan Lincoln, one of their sophomore linebacker tandem. Lincoln will be a good one. It's second and 7. Two fumbles here on this drive by Metamora, but we should point out they've used 5 minutes of the clock.
Well, again, they want to come in this direction right in here, and he loses the ball right about here. Right there. The guard pulled. The guard was going to pull, and the guard hit him in the hand, and down goes the ball.
Metamora has held the ball for over 5 minutes on this opening drive. They're faced with a third and 10 in Joliet Catholic territory. And Joe Curran will stop Stam for a loss of a yard. Joe Stam, who had earlier busted a 39-yarder, he needed 10, he loses 2. And another key fourth down here for the Redbirds. And they will punt.
Well, having been able to control the ball for this length of time in this first quarter is a confidence boost for the offensive linemen for Metamora. They're coming off the field and they're saying, Coach, we can play with these guys. Let's just keep running the ball. So that was really a good series, even though they're going to have to give it up.
Joe Stam doubles as the punter. And now he'll have to run or throw. And it is incomplete, and the Hilltoppers from Joliet Catholic will have the ball, but a flag is thrown, a late flag thrown at about the 35, and now another flag goes down.
Couple things could be going on here. Lyman downfield, but he threw the ball to number 35. So we'll have to see what this call is. That's what it is. Lineman downfield on that forward pass.
They will talk to Mike Pullman. Pullman will say, we don't want it.
We want the ball.
And eligible downfield against the offense, declaring for our first down.
And there are the officials working today's 4A state championship game. Of course, we have the tallest referee in the state of Illinois working this one. And Dan Sharp will have his team ready to take the ball offensively at his own 39-yard line, surviving a drive that used up half of this first quarter clock. We'll get that offensive starting lineup to you right after this. Quarterback is Jason Lynch. We will see maybe a series or two from him. He predominantly plays tight end. But Lynch will run it. He has room, looks for a block, gets one from Hudex. Jason Lynch has the ball down inside the 35-yard line of Metamora. Joliet Catholic Academy after the 25-yard run from Lynch. Here is that huge offensive line. You put Koloje, Garland, 280-300 on that line. On the right side, Steve Douglas, the right tackle, maybe playing as well as any offensive lineman in the state, according to Coach Gordy Gillespie. In the backfield, we talk about J.R. Zorzinski with his 1,900 yards. Don't overlook Chris Gruber. He's rushed for over 1,000 himself.
A lot of firepower in that backfield.
And there's some firepower on that defensive front. It comes in the form of big number 76, Bob Kochendorfer.
Well, they tried to run an inside trap there, and they didn't fool anybody up front for Metamora. They stayed home and did a nice job of stopping that.
Defensively for the Redbirds from Metamora, they can go toe-to-toe with you. Kenny Robertson, of course, at nose guard. You've got your quick man there at 5'10", 170. Kochendorfer and Mitchell are two-way players. Linebackers, Andy Kamen and Jack Dansart have really stepped it up in the secondary. Schertz, Panair, Schlemmer, and McCoy. Swarzynski to the outside. The first down and more. On his feet. To the 11.
See, this is where the difference comes in when you have a big back, 215 pounds, the amount of yards that he makes after he's hit. This is going to be a counter from the bottom of the screen. They're going to fake here to the fullback and come back around here. And just watch this kid go right here, number two. Watch right now. There's one hit right there. Second hit, third hit. 8 to 9 yards after that first hit. That's the difference in having that kind of a size and that kind of speed.
But the 24-yard run by Zwierzynski will be called back a holding call. So penalties here in the opening minutes of this 4A state championship game, obviously playing a big role.
Holding. Here's the offense. Replay, second down.
The ball will go to the 39-yard line. So now Joliet Catholic Academy faced with a second down and long. One thing about the Hilltoppers, Dan Sharp said, you know, we were here last year. We think we had more team speed last year, but this offense this year may be a little bit more multidimensional. They may need to be right here. They'll try the right side. The carry by Gruber. And let's go down on the sidelines to Daryl Burnett. Daryl.
Thank you, Dave. One of the critical components for Metamora isn't getting a chance to play today. Luke Mowry, you tore your ACL in the final regular season game. What are your emotions having to watch your team and not being able to play?
This is one of the hardest things I've ever had to go through. Obviously, you know, I want to be out there playing, but I'm just going to try to, you know, still keep my, you know, leadership up and hopefully we'll get a win today.
So far, two critical penalties, one on each side, or else we might have a score right now.
Yeah, I thought that was a kind of a weird call, but we'll see what goes on. You know, calls, you know, they don't usually determine the outcome of the game, so everything should be all right today.
Luke, thanks for stopping by. Best of luck. Let's go back up top.
Well, Daryl, I don't know if Luke would have wanted to turn around and see that one, because J.R. Zwierzynski will take this one for 28 yards and a first down at the 7-yard line.
The whole backfield flow is going to come down to the bottom of the screen here, and then they're coming right back here around the corner, and that's the reverse counter. And, of course, with his speed, he's got a chance of going all the way. Great effort here to knock him out of bounds on the 6-yard line.
Zwierzynski lined up at the right wing. Gruber is the left wing. Lynch to keep it. And the Redbird defense will stretch it out. John Schlemmer came up hard from his secondary position. He was joined there by number 82, Kyle Dentino.
It's interesting nowadays to see how well these big kids move. Left guard Steve Bow, number 50, pulled out on that play, and he's 6'2", 250 pounds, and he looked like a running back out in front of the back there. They have great mobility up front with all that size.
Loss of a yard on the play. And firing off sides is Carlos Garcia, the right guard. That will push it back up another 5 yards, and it will be second and goal from the 12. As far as today's game, both teams have had the ball one time. Jack, the keys.
Well, we thought originally Joliet Catholic needed to throw the ball just good because ball. They have such a great misdirection running game that they could get big plays off the pass. And then, of course, the second part of it is the offensive line play. Joliet Catholic is huge, but Metamora is just as big. So line play is going to be a crucial element in today's game for both teams. Metamora, how well they're going to block at the point of attack for the fullback and the quarterback. That's going to be a key. Up front is the where the game's going to go today.
Inside hand, up goes Rosinski. He's hit by Ryan McCoy, but not until he gets to the 6-yard line.
Kind of interesting how they're working the reverses, because they're getting those linebackers to fast flow. The play is going to come out here. Rather than go out here, he's going to come up inside on this play and try and kick out. You can see 66 trapping right there. And Zerwinski has that inside power as well as that outside speed.
Number 66 is the right tackle, Steve Douglas, having a phenomenal year. It's third and goal.
Well, with the dad as a coach, you would expect that.
They try Gruber to the right side. He's in. Chris Gruber, the touchdown with 2:02 to play in the first quarter. His 12th rushing touchdown of the season.
Again, misdirection, trying to get the flow of the backfield. The flow is going this way, and we're going to get the back coming back in here. You can see right here, they're getting those linebackers to fast flow initially, and then they're coming back, and they're doing a great job of blocking at the point of attack.
So the Hilltoppers from Joliet Catholic Academy able to overcome their penalty. And now Craig Tomasino out of the hold of Jaworski. Will give Joliet Catholic Academy the 7-0 lead, scoring on their first drive of the game after stopping Metamora on their first. We've gone from one end of the field to the other. The bottom line, JCA 7, Metamora nothing, and you are watching the IHSA Television Network. Joliet Catholic Academy, 60 yards and 8 plays. They use 3 minutes and 48 seconds off this first quarter clock, and Gruber's score puts them on top. And Jack, I felt like coming into this game, it was very important, so important for Metamora, especially after what happened last year, for the Redbirds to strike first. And indeed, it appeared as if they had with Stamps Run. What's this do right now to the emotions?
Well, I think that they almost feel as if they did strike first, because they controlled the clock and the ball for so long in that first quarter. And they had a great drive, and they did score. Penalties held them back, but I think they developed some confidence in that series.
Nick Panair will take the short kickoff, and were it not for the cartwheel tackle of Jake Jaworski, he may have had a bit more as he has it to the 35, and that will be the same spot that the Redbirds started their last drive.
And during that series, Dave, they had to come back with some big third down plays, and they did come through, and so that also developed some confidence.
1885. How about that? That's a few years ago. The very first known football game between Illinois high schools. Lakeview and South Division.
Didn't Jim O'Boy see that game? I thought he had a program in that game.
On the option pitch right side, Ferguson will lose a yard. Jaworski came up hard. And you can see the rain that's coming down. It is absolutely miserable here today. Temperature in the mid-30s, raining, misting. The crowd is scattered all about Memorial Stadium, just looking for the driest place they can get. There is your current conditions, and that's about as raw as it can be. Now, last year when these two teams played, it was about 65 degrees and sunny. So same two teams, same situation, different weather. Stamp in the open field is dangerous. Takes a hit, gets a first down.
Well, when he puts the ball up in the air as if he's going to pass it, that forces the linebackers to stay off. So what he's doing is he's spreading it out, And he's, when he drops back, as long as the quarterback has the ball in his hands, and this is the key, as long as he's there with the ball, those linebackers are still deep and so is the secondary. This is the key. The way he put the ball up, he kept those secondary people off the line. He was able to scramble and make a first down.
It's become very obvious here early why Stam averaged over 10 yards per carry. Alvis is being keyed on today. He'll carry a couple of men, but only for about a yard ride. How big are these teams?
Well, that's kind of interesting. When you talk about that, look at the size of that. Can you imagine what the dinners must have been like yesterday? It's 254 versus 240. Now, that's what the matchup right there. And then, of course, linebacker size here is unbelievable. But that is a big factor right there, the two sides of the offense and defensive lines. These kids are really big, and the other thing is they really run well.
Definitely the biggest team Metamora has played this year. Joliet Catholic played Mount Carmel, similar size. Rick Alvis, 1,400-yard rusher, and he gets there and he hurts you.
This is the key to Metamora's offense for the last 25 years. Right here, the fullback going in this direction or that direction. Right inside the tackles is where Metamora must get that fullback to run, and there's a perfect example right there of their offense, the key to their offense.
The first quarter in the 2000 Class 4A State Championship is in the book. Pat Ryan looking to break the hex, the second place hex. As far as his team is concerned, they finished fourth three of the last 4 years. After one quarter, it's Joliet Catholic 7, Metamora nothing, and we'll be back after this local break. Memorial Stadium, the site for the 2000 State Football Championships. This is the 4A Championship. Two more games to follow today.
You know, it's interesting for Metamora. They're trying to figure out which side to run. On one side, you have Pat McShane, who is an all-everything football player. And if you run away from him, you got to run at Mike Koloje. And he's a great one at 280 pounds, 6'7". So it's really a dilemma. They have two great bookend defensive ends, and it's tough not to run in one of their directions. That's why they're going to use a lot of misdirection, I think.
They're down the ball in Joliet Academy territory as we start the second quarter. Alvis keeps the feet chugging, and he will be very close to that first down at the 43. Statistically, in the first half, take a look at time of possession. 8 minutes, and it gives you nothing.
Well, that's the key when you think that they had that basically all on their first drive. And here's the other key, right here. Now, if that continues, they're going to have a problem, because with the size of the defensive line of Joliet Catholic, they're going to have to do something about this issue right here. A lot of lines there, but that zero right there is something that has got to change for Metamora to stay in this ballgame. They're going to have to throw the ball at some point or another, just play action to keep Joliet Catholic's defensive secondary off the line of scrimmage. They're giving them basically a 9- and 10-man front.
Stam has some room. Oh, and a great open field tackle by Jake Jaworski. I'm telling you something, if Jaworski does not get him, Stam turns it upfield for another 10.
Well, the other part of that is if he ends up pitching the ball, he's got a big play. Now, when he comes out on the perimeter, you'll see that there is nobody covering the pitch man. He's got the ball, he's turned up inside. The guy out here is the key. Nobody is covering the pitch man. I would assume the Metamora coaches will get to that soon. They'll start pitching the ball on the perimeter.
Picked up about 3 yards on first down. This is Adam Schertz. He will go nowhere. Andrew Damiani, 5'7", 240 pounds, is the strongest man on this Hilltopper squad, and he was not going to let Schertz get away from him. Damiani is one of these guys you love to have on your team in weightlifting competitions. He just gets out there and does the job.
Well, most of these kids nowadays are so chiseled that, the day of a big 250-pounder being slovenly is over. These kids are all well-built from the weight programs.
Another third and long. Stam tries to outrun Damiani. He does. He's got the first down. Stam out of bounds. He will be at the 24 of Joliet Catholic. 16 yards on the run for Stam.
Well, again, he wanted to throw the ball, and just the threat of throwing the ball loosens up the secondary. The linebackers drop off, the secondary stays off, and of course, his value is his feet. Right now, it's just the threat of him running. The secondary stays off, and he's able to scramble. It's exactly the same as a pass as far as he's concerned, except he's got positive yards with that run.
Stan, the quarterback in this game last year for Metamora, had a very difficult time handling the way the game got away from his club. And now with some confusion as far as who should be on the field, Metamora will be forced to use their first timeout of this half. 7-0, Joliet Catholic scoring on their lone drive, and that's where we sit with 10-10 left to play in the first half. This is the IHSA Television Network. It is November. It is the 4A State Football Championships, and it is the weather you would expect. Absolutely miserable. Winds blowing a rain now. It was a mist earlier, blowing a rain across the field pretty much from left to right as you take a look at it. Metamora, as we said last year in this championship game, in nicer conditions, but how about that? Four times in the last 5 years, they're playing on the very last day of the season.
That's a tremendous football program. They've been in the state championship game 7 times since the state playoffs have started.
First down as we resume action. Joliet Catholic strings it out, the late pitch to Ferguson.
That's a good, solid football play. They had two people on Stam, and they're able to now get to the pitch man, and this will be a key factor. Somebody's got to take the pitch man, but Stam is such a threat that when he follows, he's actually following the fullback. There's nobody on the pitch man. Right there, you can see they jumped on him, and they're taking the pitch man as a secondary choice, and hopefully, as far as Metamora is concerned, that's going to lead to some big yards as the game wears on.
Well, you had Pullman and Brosi's pair of safeties along with Pat McShane chasing him out of bounds.
See, this again, this formation will loosen up right here.
There it is. Stam needs one block. He's in. Joe Stam, his 24th touchdown of the year. 18 yards. And with the state record holder and point after touchdowns coming up, Metamora is within seconds of tying this up.
This formation led to the touchdown. He runs off tackle here, but right up in this area here was a spread formation. You can see the defensive backs right there. They were off the ball and had to play the receiver. So just by formation, they spread out Joliet Catholic. That was a great call by Coach Ryan.
Anthony Elger for the extra point. His kick is good. That's his 80th of the year, and he continues to add to a season record point after touchdowns. But more importantly, we are tied at 7. 2 minutes into the second quarter in the 4A state championship, a rematch of last season when these two teams met on this very field. It was a close game for about a quarter and a half before Joliet Catholic opened it up 48-13, the final, a little bit different story today.
But you know, through this whole series here, even in the first time the Metamora had the ball, they just looked as if they felt like they can control the ball and run the ball. And of course, this last scoring drive showed us the same situation that they had in the first quarter. They're able to move the football. The only reason that they don't have another 7 on the board is because they've been making a couple mistakes that put themselves in bad situations with penalties. But they're proving to everybody that they can play with Joliet Catholic, and that could be an interesting factor as we move along here.
We'd like you to interact here in our broadcast here in the 4A State Championship, and here's how you can do it. We're going to ask you a question, then you see down at the bottom of your screen, you reply at tv@ihsa.org. Come along, play along with us. First person in with the correct answer to this one, who won the first Class 4A state title in 74? First person in, we send you an IHSA cap. And this kickoff will go out of the end zone, and Joliet Catholic Academy will bring it out to the 20. So answer in, tv@ihsa.org. Well, now the field becomes a little bit longer for Joliet Catholic. They average 9.4 yards per play in their lone scoring drive. Now they start from their 20. Time of possession, 10 minutes and 14 seconds for Metamora to just 3:48 for the Hilltoppers. And there are yards on the ground. That's not a surprise if you're a Metamora fan.
But you know, it's really not a surprise in either direction because both of these teams are power running teams. That's their attack. They both run the ball extremely well.
Neither team has stopped the other. Craig Tomasino in at quarterback. Chris Gruber with it. He's across the 25. Now, we told you that you would see Tomasino. Tomasino, the junior quarterback for Joliet Catholic, has taken the majority of snaps. Jason Lynch started quarterback, but he will not leave the game. He will go in and play an offensive end, a tight end, if you will. In fact, he was told that, Lynch was, early in the season. He said, you know, Jason, Dan Sharp told him, you're going to play. You're going to play every single offensive plays. But Tomasino, a little bit more of a Joe Montana-type quarterback.
That offensive line averages 248 pounds for Joliet Catholic.
They just picked up 8 yards for Gruber. Anthony Hickey is the center. This is Zorzinski. Makes a hole and more. Zorzinski across midfield. A prototypical run from J.R. Zorzinski. This one goes for 23 yards. He combines the power and the finesse.
Well, the key to this play was really how watch the lineman up here pulling and coming down right in here. Here he comes, and he's going to be kicking out. All these offensive linemen stretching out, the linebackers for Metamora. All those big kids that we talked about earlier can all run, and that creates a great running lane and some good lead blockers for Zorzinski.
First down in Metamora territory. Gruber, he's hit, stuck. John Mitchler with the tackle. There is a brain trust like no other.
There's the pass king, and here's the new king.
Gordy Gillespie on the right. He won 5 state championships. Dan Sharp, you're looking at him right there, the current head coach, his 4th year at Joliet Catholic Academy, played for Gordy. He coached under Gordy at Joliet Catholic and at the College of St. Francis. And now those two teaming up here at JCA. It's almost not fair.
I'm just going to say that.
Zorzinski looking for a block from Garcia, doesn't get it. It's strung out by Metamora. Excellent job on pursuit from Kyle Dentino. We talk about how big these teams are. We can flip it around this way. We've got some pretty nice numbers we were talking about before the game. This is college size.
Well, you know, we talked about this earlier. The reverse of this, the same thing. Both of these people are so big. There cannot possibly be any turkeys left in the state of Illinois, certainly in the Joliet or Metamora area. They've got to all be gone, or they're certainly left town. That's a lot of big kids to feed.
Key third down. Tomasino waits on the block from Garcia, gets it, and he may be just a bit short. Nick Pinnaire was there, also Ryan McCoy, number 23. Adam Church, number 2, picks himself up off the pile.
And I would certainly think that Joliet Catholic will go for it when you have an offensive line at 248 pounds.
You know, the 1A state championship game yesterday, Carthage, 14-0 winners over Northwestern. Carthage did not attempt a pass, so obviously they had no passing yards. Well, guess what? Nobody's been able to throw the ball, catch the ball here today either.
But at least Metamora looked like they attempted. I mean, he dropped back, and that's as close as it came to a pass, and then he, of course, scrambled.
Less than a yard to go here on fourth down.
Power off tackle.
Here it comes, Zorzinski, he's got it. Well, you have your offensive line averaging up around the 250, 260 mark. You figure you can get about a foot.
Well, what they do is they shift over the fullback to exactly where they're going. They run right in this area here. And you and I could have picked up a first down on that one, Dave. Well,
no,
maybe me.
You could have. Neither team has really stopped the other. It's just been a pound, pound, pound sort of game. This is only, as we approach the 6.5-minute mark of the second quarter, only the second possession for Joliet Catholic Academy. Here comes Zorzinski. He slices the hole. And there you see the effects of the rain that we've had here over the past 6-7 hours.
Again, classic Joliet Catholic misdirection play. Giving you plays in one direction to get the linebackers and even the secondary to rotate, and they come back with a little counter in the reverse. Big plays with linemen pulling out in front of them.
7 yards for Zorzinski. He right now has carried the ball 7 times for 79 yards. He's left his team 3 yards short of a first down. Greg Tomasino is the quarterback. Fullback is Brad Hudetz. Hudetz does not carry the ball much. He's got himself a first down as he gets inside the 25. Hudetz on the season. this 423 yards, which I guess for most teams, that's quite a season, but when you got a 2,000-yard back in your backfield, you just kind of get lost in the shuffle.
And 400 of those yards were right, basically on that type of play, right up the middle, just a short trap, the guard pulls, and he pops up in because the linebackers are flowing out to get the perimeter because of the two great backs, so he's able to pop it up inside.
Fresh set of downs for JCA. Gruber gets a block from Bow, brought down at the 21-yard line. And do we have a fumble on the play? Metamora fumbled twice, recovered it both times, and if we indeed had one there, Hilltoppers will have it. Hey, you know, for the most up-to-date Illinois high school sports information, all you have to do is click on the IHSA's website. That's right, right there it is, IHSA.org. What do you get? You get scores, standings, and a whole lot more. Now, this website, the IHSA website, this is your number one source if you're an Illinois high school sports fan. Absolutely fabulous from day one till day end, the IHSA sports seasons. A second and seven. Tomasino, his first pass today. But he's got some room. Tomasino brought down. It looked like something good was going to happen there for a moment, but then Justin Heft closed the door.
Well, he would have been, unless that was a ploy by the dropback, he would have been thrown into a very strong wind. So I think it was almost a quarterback draw. They're giving the appearance of a pass, but it's more or less like a quarterback draw.
Here's one of the great guys in Illinois high school football, Pat Ryan.
Great guy.
And obviously, he's here for the fourth time in 5 years, a five-year record the last 5 years of 64-7. And Metamora ready for that inside handoff. Tomasino to Gruber to Brzezinski to the 15. Bob Kochendorfer with the tackle, 300 pounds, stood in the way of Brzezinski.
The other interesting thing about Pat Ryan and Metamora in his 11 years as the head coach, his record is 102-26. That's an incredible record. And Metamora as a program, traditionally, they've been in this game seven times, the state championship game. Some teams, obviously, just to get in it once. And of course, Joliet Catholic is in their 11th state championship game. Just astronomical numbers for these two programs.
Now Ryan's defense will have to defend on a fourth and less than a yard. Gruber will have the first down and more to the 10. Inside the 5. It looked early, Jack, that he was in a little bit of trouble. Gruber waited, the hole then opened.
Well, you know, it's strictly all power. They're going right up in here, and everybody's kicking out, and he's getting the blocks. You can just see just a great effort, a hard run, and lowers his shoulders. And that's one of the reasons why he has over 1,000 yards, 190 pounds. He's a tough, tough fullback.
First and goal from the 4-yard line.
Again, a power formation for them.
Give to Zwarzynski, and lining up the tailback position, gets to the 2.
They're telling you where they're going, but you've got to stop them. It's a complete overload on one side. They kind of mismatch you as far as numbers, and they just run right at you, and all they're looking for is short yardage. Right now, they're only going to need 2 yards.
Both teams have run the ball 21 times apiece. Joliet Catholic, 153 yards to 105 for Metamora, but two very important yards yet to be had here for JCA.
This is where those huge offensive lines are very helpful. And they're going to be running right up in here.
Brzezinski, he's not going to get there. He may not have gotten back to the line. Off the pile, Nick Panair, also with Ryan McCoy, so a couple of members of the Redbird secondary make an impact.
Now again, they're not being fancy. They're telling you where they're going. He's coming right up in here behind this blocking back. Nothing fancy, it's just all power football. Great job by the Metamora defense.
Timeout, Metamora.
Metamora has elected to use their second timeout of this first half. It comes with a minute 58 to play the Hilltoppers at the 2-yard line.
Band, your official IHSA football.
A little bit earlier, we asked you trivia question. And again, we don't know these questions. Do you know the answer? If so, this was the place you wanted to be. TV at IHSA.org. And that question again today, we take you back in time. 1974, the first Class 4A championship game was held. Who won it? Rockford East got Normal Community.
You can order extra official apparel by mail.
Jeff Hahn from Polo, our winner, and we will be sending you an IHSA cap for that one. So give it to Rockford East, 1974. This is the 27th year here, the state championships. We've moved through four classes, five classes, six. It will be eight next year. Six classes here played this weekend at Memorial Stadium.
We've moved through classes. We've moved through sites. Illinois State, Champaign, Dyke Stadium. You know, we've been all over. It's been an interesting transition.
Memorial Stadium, the site last year, this year, and for the next three after it. A great setting. The Hilltoppers were here last year from Joliet Catholic. They defeated Metamora. Now they look to take the lead in this one. And they do. Swarzynski. Touchdown number 32 on the season, his 28th on the ground. And with a minute 51 left to play here in the first half, it's a 13-7 JCA lead.
Well, the key here is Carlos. He's the one that pulls number 65 right there. He's leading up, and he's the power lineman, and they're just blocking down and kicking out and running in behind that 215-pound running back. I'd give him the ball every time myself.
Craig Tomasino on to stretch this to a 7-point lead. He is 22 out of 25 in extra points this season. The wind blowing directly in his face. Tomasino has been accurate all year, but not this time. A 6-point difference, and that is huge, especially the way these two teams have moved the ball here today. The Hilltoppers going 80 yards in 15 plays for the go-ahead score. Swarzynski's touchdown, 32 on the season. And for Swarzynski, he now has 216 points scored this year. That is obviously tops. He is tops in career points, by the way, at Joliet Catholic Academy. And who's number two? Well, a guy by the name of Mike Allstott.
Can you imagine coaching Mike Allstott, and then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, comes somebody that's going to break all of his records? That's just mind-boggling for a coach to think. Sometimes you get a back like that once in your career, and he's playing with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, and out comes some young man that is going to break those records as a junior, and he's got another year to go. My goodness.
There is JR right there. 24 two-point conversions. That's not fair either. You know, you think about the pressure put on a young man when you see Mike Allstott's accomplishments, but Swarzynski may be one of the most humble players around. He just doesn't like all the attention. He'll deflect the credit to his offensive line, and indeed, deservedly so, but he has an entire senior season of football left to be played. He indeed will be one of the top recruits nationally next season.
What's kind of interesting is Chris Gruber, number 20, they're best friends, and they're always hoping the other guy will get the ball so they can block for each other. And they're actually their best friends and their best cheerleaders for each other. They're both trying to do the best for the other guy. And I think when you have that kind of chemistry in the backfield, that's what puts you in a state championship game.
Okay, so now we'll make all the other Class 4A teams feel bad if they don't already, knowing Swarzynski's coming back. His buddy Gruber is also a junior, so the wingbacks return next year for JCA.
Isn't that scary? And who knows how big Drewinski will be next year. He's 215 right now. If he keeps that speed, look out.
You see the effect of the wind here at Memorial Stadium. They have to hold the ball. And this ball is a live ball, stopping at the 27-yard line. And very dangerous today because of how slick that turf is. Adam Schertz will come up with it.
Well, that was intentional, the way he kicked that. He just pooched it up into the corner there so they get good coverage. They didn't want to give him a run back. And kicks like that are very tricky because the wind plays a problem, and you don't get a good return because it's tough to set up a wedge or anything else as far as returns. But Metamora's got the ball in pretty good field position.
They only have a minute 49 to work with. They have 73 yards to go for a tying score. Stam to the side. And once again, on a couple of occasions, Jake Jaworski has been the man to stick his hand out and trip up Stam and prevent a huge game.
Well, Stam is a threat, there's no doubt about it. With Elvis going up inside, Stam is, you're trying to block everything down in here, and he's coming around out here, and he's got a lead blocker. And Elvis is the guy that blocks for him, but Stam is a real threat.
He'll try the left side. He will keep it. And he again is one step away from making something big happen before Mike Coleman this time with the tackle.
That was a great tackle because he could have busted it right after that. So that by Mike Coleman, 5'11", 170-pound senior, was a big tackle.
I remember with 1:08 to play here in the first half, down by six, the clock running, Metamora has used two timeouts. from their own 38.
Now again, they spread them out, and when they run this formation, they usually run to it.
Stan will pick it up off the turf and try to make something happen. But it's Deed the other way. Mike Coloche will track him down, 6'7", 280 pounds. Bring Stan down for a loss of 11.
That was just a great play. He's sprinting out this way, and he never gets the ball, and all of a sudden, now you've got
10-yard loss.
A big Mike Coloche right
second
in front of him. 20. That's a great effort because he had a man open downfield. If he could have scrambled out another three steps, he might have hit that deep man.
20 seconds left here in the first half. Will this be Stan's first pass of the day? He's got a man down there. And there again, the weather conditions. You could see the ball just slipping away. Ryan McCoy, the intended receiver, he was open, and he was open in a big way.
He just ran an up and out route up here in the corner of the screen and gives him a little fake, throws the ball up in the air. And it's a combination of a wet ball, poor weather, and probably the fact that they don't throw a heck of a lot all year, that he was maybe in shock. But that would have been a big play for Metamora with 11 seconds left. They would have gave him a little one more shot to the end zone anyway.
Metamora faced now with a third down and 20 here in the first half. They've completed two of their three third down conversions of 5 or more yards. Short side of the field. Stam's not going to get 20, and he will stay in bounds. This clock will wind down unless Joliet Catholic elects to take a timeout. And they will not. They will say, you know what, we're happy. We'll go to the locker room with a 13-7 lead. So a Chris Gruber touchdown run, a Joe Stam touchdown run, tied us at 7. You come back, Swierczynski scores. We have gone from one side of the field to the other with about as minimal amount of possessions as I can recall in one half of football.
Well, I've been impressed with Metamora. They've hung right in there, and we've got a ball game.
The Metamora Redbirds making their fourth appearance in the last 5 years in this state championship game. They have not come away with the championship since 1975. Providence Catholic derailed Metamora on two occasions, and last year, Joliet Catholic Academy on this very turf got the Redbirds in that game 48-13. This game started to get away a little bit at about this time last year, but this year is a different story. Let's go down to the sidelines right now and Daryl Burnett. Daryl.
Thank you, Dave. Coach, 13-7. As the weather worsened second half, does the game plan change?
No, you can see our game plan kind of, we tighten things down now because of the weather way it is now. We've been running pretty much out of our double tight set, but I think it's going to be a game like this because of the conditions and because of the excellent team Metamora is. If we don't snap that quarterback, it could be a long day for us. We really got to do something to clean. He's an excellent football player.
You frantically wanted a timeout at the close of the first half. What was the plan there?
Well, we wanted to get a timeout because we could have stopped it with 4 seconds left and maybe gone for a block kick, you know, and turn the game around and maybe score off a block kick or, you know, anything can happen in this situation with weather like this.
Coach, we'll let you get to the locker room. Thanks a lot. Best of luck second half.
Thank you. Try and stay dry now.
We'll try. Let's go back up top.
All right, Daryl. In fact, I think there's about 5 of us in this stadium that are dry. Everybody else soaking wet. 13-7, your score at the half. We'll take a break and we'll be right back after this local break. 13-7 here in the 4A championship, the Hilltoppers with the 6-point lead.
It's halftime at Memorial Stadium. Joliet Catholic leads at 13-7. I'm joined by two distinguished guests here. Dave Ganaway, Assistant Executive Director of the IHSA. John Helmick, who coached Metamora to a state championship back in 1975 and runner-up finishes in the next 2 years. John, let me start with you. First of all, you had this gentleman on my right on your staff. What kind of a coach was he?
Hey, I taught him everything he knows. No, he's the type of coach that was energetic, enthusiastic, had to kind of calm him down once in a while. But he was really fun. We had a lot of fun coaching together, a lot of fun.
John, you had a chance to see the first half here. What are your thoughts as a coach and as a spectator?
Somehow Metamora's got to keep the ball. They can't let Joliet handle the ball.
Ladies and gentlemen,
they eat up the clock. They move the ball well. Metamora has to eat up the clock and keep the ball and keep the ball out of Joliet's hands.
For the fans who remember that 1975 championship team, how would it compare to this Metamora team in 2000?
I think this Metamora team is much bigger and much stronger than that team was. That was a good, awfully good 1975 team. I'm real proud of that team, but I think this team's probably a little bit more talented.
John, enjoy the second half. Hopefully Metamora, for your sake, comes back in the second half. Dave, let's turn to you now. You had Pat Ryan on your staff.
Yeah, I coached Pat when he was a freshman. Tom Gilhouse and I were the freshman coaches, and we had Pat there. So we had to give him all of his basic knowledge to start with. So,
what kind of a coach is he? How would you characterize him on the sidelines?
Pat has been fun to watch mature as a coach, and I think he just does an excellent job right now. Maybe one of the best things Pat does right now is what he's doing right now in at halftime. I've seen several of his games, and I think Pat just does an excellent job making adjustments at halftime, and we'll see what happens.
Dave, we can't let you get away without talking about the IHSA and some of the plans. We're going to two additional classes next year. Can you briefly tell us how that's going to break out?
Well, we'll be looking at that next week at the advisory committee. Looking at possibilities, maybe we'll look at running two sessions on Friday and two on Saturday and run 1A, 2A, and then clear and 3A, 4A, and then do it again on Saturday. So we're not quite for sure exactly how that's going to play out. The seating and everything, I think, will be very similar to the way it's been done this year. And we'll just have to stay tuned till after the advisory committee and then the recommendations going to the board of directors.
Well, Dave, certainly I'm sure with the turf the way it is and the weather the way it is, you have to be happy the way that that's going right now. So thanks for joining us at halftime. We'll be back with more of the halftime festivities from Memorial Stadium coming up after this local break. Stay with us. It's 13-7 at halftime. Joliet Catholic leads Metamora in the 4A championship game. As you can see, for the moment, the weather has broken a bit. Midway through the second quarter, it was pouring out here, threatening to turn into ice. But right now, hopefully it will hold off and so we can have a great second half. While we have this break here at halftime, let's go over and listen to the Metamora band so they can entertain you here at halftime. We have about 6 minutes to go before the second half kickoff. We'll take a break down the line for all of our local stations here watching the IHSA television network. Now this local break.
We're at halftime here at the 4A State Football Championships. Joliet Catholic Academy bidding for their ninth state championship. That would be a state record, and they lead the Redbirds from Metamora by six. We welcome you back here, as Darrell talked about earlier. Very cold, very brisk, and it's Kind of interesting, Jack. You take a look at the fans and the stands. They are scattered all about Memorial Stadium. They're not clustered the way we've seen in the past.
No, they're trying to get a little cover underneath the bleachers there from the mist and the rain that's been going on. I feel sorry for the players. Here they are in the biggest game of their lives, and two undefeated teams. They have all this skill, and they're playing under terrible conditions, but they're putting on a pretty good show.
Indeed. You know, we talked about these two teams being able to score points. Metamora this season, five times they scored over 60 points in a game. That's right, they averaged over 30 points per half this season. As far as Joliet Catholic is concerned, they have an offense that can rack up points as well. They've done it in the playoffs, they've done it here, and they have a variety of backs they can go to here, Chris Gruber.
Well, you know, Gruber is, everybody keys on Zerwinski, but Gruber is an outstanding back with over 1,000 yards himself. So they're not one-dimensional. They basically are two-dimensional with two backs to go over 1,000 yards and a big offensive line. They're tough to stop, and they have been all year.
As far as Metamora is concerned, they have their marquee player as well, Joe Stamm. He made it happen in the first half.
Well, Stamm is really a Matt Zerwinski step for step. He's only 2 yards off and has fewer carries, but the key is they're going to have to establish Elvis inside for Stamm to continue to do the outside running.
That last touchdown by Stamm tied the game at 7, and this is Zerwinski for the lead.
Well, it's just a big, big, strong offensive line behind, and then the running of a big, strong junior back at 215 pounds. That's a load.
You know, we take a look at this particular game, and we see a six-point difference because the extra point was missed on that last conversion attempt. Now, keep this in mind. The state record holder is Anthony Elger. He's wearing a red jersey today for Metamora. That's a one-point difference, but like we were talking about during the break, so what? Joliet Catholic, known for going for two.
Well, they're not threatened when it comes to a two-point conversion. They've been doing it all season, and they're very successful with it, and they're very confident with it. On the other hand, Metamora has a kicker that's confident in his abilities, so when it comes down, push comes to shove, Joliet Catholic won't hesitate when it comes to the two-point conversions.
These two teams have had the ball for five possessions combined, and as one might expect, pretty even in terms of statistics.
Well, you know, time of possession, 10 seconds difference. That's incredible. Rushing yards, and of course, look at the passing yards. The threat was that they dropped back, not that they threw the ball. They only threw it once, both teams, the entire first half. So the threat is obviously the passing game. Who's going to loosen up with a play-action pass? Maybe nobody today. They're both running the ball extremely well. Time of possession. This is really a heavyweight battle between two teams. They're just going heel to heel and just pounding on each other.
One thing that we have not seen, we've not seen an actual turnover. We've seen the ball dropped on the turf a couple of times. That is something in a six-point game, and as Dan Sharp said, he's gearing his offense down a little bit, but that's something to keep an eye on here in the second half.
Well, really, the only thing that stopped either one of these teams in their drives, and Metamora's initial drive, was penalties. It's not so much been the weather affecting their execution, it's been penalties, and in many cases, because they're so very aggressive. So we're seeing two outstanding, well-disciplined football teams, and they're just pounding on each other, and I'm really excited about the second half.
It's been a great championship down here this past weekend. 1A, it was Carthage. Winners over Scioto Northwestern in Class 2A. Stillman Valley won that one over Tolono Unity last night. Harrisburg with the 3A championship. We are in 4A. Two games to follow that you will get right here on the IHSA television network. That's Providence Catholic and Mount Carmel. And then in the 6A championship game, it will be Maine South going against Glenbard North. And we will be bringing it to you from up high and from down low. And let's go down low right now to Daryl Burnett. Daryl?
Come to me. I got Coach. Coach, right now you're down 13-7. How does the game plan change for you now in the second half?
Well, we need to stop them here. If they get two up, you know, then it's really going to be a tough struggle for us. So we need a great kickoff like we had the last time and force them to go 80 again and make something happen. We need to get the next score. We need to be the ones to score next, get that extra point, and then, hey, will it be even again? Then we'll have to battle. But if they get two up, it'll be tough for us. We know that, so that's what we talked about. We're moving the ball, though, and we just feel like if we can get a couple stops and not turn the ball over, we still got a shot at it.
Without the penalty, it'd be a tie game right now.
Well, those things happen, and, you know, they had a penalty, too, and life goes on. You can't dwell on those things. We'd like to have that score, I tell you, but, you know, I think our kids are poised and ready to battle again. Might need a break or two, but, you know, we're still pretty focused, and I still think we can win it.
Coach, go for it in second half.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Let's go back upstairs.
Thank you very much, Daryl, and it's interesting because 1 year ago, as we said, these two teams met. At halftime of that game, it was starting to fall away from Metamora, but you could just hear from the tone of Pat Ryan's voice that this is a game the Redbirds feel they are in and they can win. And we expect you to come right back here for the second half. As Jack says, he can't wait. I hope you can't either. This is the IHSA Television Network. Memorial Stadium here on the campus of the University of Illinois. Wet, cold, but yet it's the state championship, and that's why we are here, and we're happy that you have joined us
as well. The Hilltoppers from Joliet Catholic Academy looking to lay the gauntlet down to Mount Carmel. And why is that? Well, both of those teams have won 8 state football championships. And Mount Carmel will be playing in the very next game here in Class 5A. And, of course, we invite you to join us for that one. The kickoff for that game will be 3 p.m. this afternoon. So Mount Carmel waiting to see what happens with Joliet Catholic Academy. As far as Metamora is concerned, they're tired of this second place business. It's time to get down and to get that second state championship. As you said, saw earlier at halftime, John Helmick, the head coach, he got the first one back in 1975. But Jack, just before we went to break, I made the comment that there just seems to be a different feeling in this Metamora team this year as they come out of the locker room.
Well, maturity. You had 5 starters on offense returning from last year's team. You had 5 starters from defense returning from last year's team. Last year's team, the semifinal seemed to be their championship game. They were thrilled that they won the semifinal to get down here. And it was like all the air was let out of the balloon after the semifinal game because it was a whole different team. They were young, they were immature. Now this year, they were much more poised and much more reserved after they won the semifinal game because their job wasn't finished. They hadn't completed their goal, which was to win the state championship. And that shows a sign of maturity with the team when it's not the semifinals that they get excited about winning, it's the state championship.
But you heard Pat Ryan. He said, we must get a stop. How do you do it?
Well, first of all, with an offense such as Joliet Catholic, with that misdirection, it's very, very difficult. But the thing that you got to do is you got to say, which guy is going to hurt us the worst? Is it going to be Huber or is it going to be Zerwinski? I would say, I'm going to take away Zerwinski, beat us with Huber, and go from there. Now, on the other side, Metamora drove in the opening drive and scored. So, you know, we said, let's reflect back in the second half and think about that first touchdown that was called back. Here we're looking at a 13-7 lead for Joliet Catholic. That touchdown looms very large right now. But the big part of it is, was the confidence level that Metamora gained in that opening drive knowing they could score. So I think right now, Metamora has something going for itself.
The first team that stops the other may be the team to win this ballgame. Now, Joliet Catholic will receive this second half kickoff. They went 80 yards the last time they touched the ball. A turnover, I mentioned it earlier, turnover could be key. A stoppage on downs could be key, and you've got to believe your marquee players, Stam, Zerwinski, whether you take away Zerwinski or not, they may be the guys to bring home that state championship to their respective communities.
Well, the stars are always the one that you want to have the football in their hands at the end, and I think that's what's going to be the in the conclusion of this game, who has the ball and who's been getting the most carries with it, either Stam or Zerwinski.
Talk very briefly about the 5A and 6A games coming up. As you can see, how miserable it is. I'll tell you what you do. If you're at home right now in the state of Illinois, open up your window, let the air blow on you, and maybe turn a cold shower on, and you might get somewhat the effect. 37 degrees, you've got a wind blowing, the rain coming and going in different levels. It's just not a fun day, unless your team's playing for the state championship.
And our families thought we came down here to be on vacation, right? This is work. I'm freezing.
You wonder whether those guys down there are feeling it right now. You know, a number of players being in their second state championship game as we reenact the coin toss here for the second half. Joliet Catholic will receive. But a number of these players playing their second state championship game. How about the experience? I mean, we talked, the weather's completely different than last year, but the experience of just being down here, being on this turf in a 70,000-seat stadium.
It's a whole comfort level. Just to walk in the locker room before the game. You're familiar with this setting. You've been here before. It's not, they're not awestruck. It's the University of Illinois. It's Champaign. It's a Big Ten field. They've been here before. They were here last year.
There was a big sign that the Metamora cheerleaders pulled out in front of their stands before the game. It had all the numbers of all the players for Metamora, and on it, it said, it's our turn. Well, they are 24 minutes away from making it their turn, but they trail JCA by 6. You get a look at number 99 back there. That's Pat McShane. That's right, folks. He's one of the deep return men for Joliet Catholic. He's a defensive end extraordinaire with 15 sacks in a season. He also returns the kicks. Anthony Elger will wiggle this one down to the 15. Takes a decent hop. Luke Stenberg, good speedster, and he coughs it up.
Could this be what Coach Ryan was talking about? Nope.
Nope.
They got it back.
Luke Stenberg, great speed. His first hit he's taken on the day, and that could have been exactly what the Redbirds wanted. But instead, Joliet Catholic Academy to take over at the 33-yard line. A 21-yard return for Stenberg. Mike Koloje will stay on the field offensively. Now Koloje, McShane will rotate offense, defense, playing the tight end spot. Jason Lynch, if he's not the quarterback, will be the other tight end for Joliet Catholic. But the philosophy offensively for Joliet Catholic is we want those two big guys, Koloje and McShane, to rest on offense. They need them on defense. You see number six, Lynch, will start the second half at quarterback. He ran that first scoring drive today for the Hilltoppers.
Now this first series will be very interesting for Metamora. We got a flag here for delay of game, I think.
How about that? You come off the sidelines after the kickoff and can't get it done.
Good ball, delay of game against the offensive team.
Now, what is abnormal here for these kids is there is a clock in both end zones. So they're probably not familiar with that because we don't have that in our normal high school games, but down here there is. So once they get used to that, and I'm sure that'll be brought to the attention of the quarterbacks by the coaches after the series.
Looking at 15 yards on first down to start the second half. The pitch to Gruber. Waiting for the block, it never came. Chris Gruber is kind of tiptoeing out there expecting the pull. But then Zach Bittner said, not my way.
See, that's a much easier play to defend than their normal misdirection because he's got the ball immediately with the pitch. You know where he's going. There was no back coming the other way. It was a power pitch off tackle, so you could get full flow pursuit by the defensive backs and the linebackers, and they certainly stuffed it.
Long count here by Lynch. Fullback, Huditz. He got a pretty good hole up the middle. As we said, Brad Huditz does not carry the ball much, only 77 times coming in. The stop was made by Kyle Dentino. He's been in on a few plays today.
Well, what they're looking for is to get movement out here and then run the fullback right up in here. They're trying to get these linebackers to move. And right there, they got some flow outside by Zerwinski's movement, and that allowed the fullback to get some yardage up inside.
Now we will see as Wierzynski and Gruber split to the top right corner of your screen. First time we've seen this formation today. Motion from Wierzynski. He gets the handoff. He can't turn the corner. John Schlemmer, the first man to slow him down. And here will be the opportunity that Pat Ryan wanted for his defense.
They wanted to give him a running start coming off the slot. And he's going to come fast flow in here, hopefully, to beat all of these people. And the outside people did a great job of containing right here. You can see him coming up right there. And that's a great job of pursuit, a great job of tackling. Wow.
On fourth down, they will show this formation and then shift to Wierzynski, who is the punter. First time today for Wierzynski to punt.
And into a strong wind.
No pressure. With the left foot, looking for a roll. There's the stop that Pat Ryan from Metamora wanted. 30-yard kick for Wierzynski from the 32-yard line is where the Redbirds will have it.
Now, the other part of this is field position. You know, you can play the field position game when you have inclement weather and try and take advantage of the situation as far as put him in the hole against the wind and this and that. And this could be the ploy here to start out with, but Metamora's got to move the ball and then try and, if they don't score, put Joliet Catholic down in the hole again.
Joe Stamm is the quarterback. The fullback is Rick Alvis. He has been quiet so far today. A 14-yard gainer on the season. And Alvis will get that first carry here in the third quarter.
That was almost a quarterback sneak. You saw how close the fullback was to the quarterback. Just take a look at where the fullback lines up. He is directly right here. I mean, there is no place. It might as well be a quarterback sneak. And he hands off the ball right here. And the chances for lost yardage there are very slim.
John Mischler is the right guard. You saw him briefly there, number 64. He did not play in this game last year. He broke a leg in the quarterfinals. So a broken leg sideline. Mischler looking to make the most of it here today. Ferguson had to stutter a little bit, then he ran into the arms of Pat McShane. Also getting up off the bottom of the pile, number 52, is Sean O'Connor. He got help from linebacker Ryan Lincoln.
Well, he had some size in front of him. He had Warwick at 285 and Otto at 250 pulling out in front of him, the left guard and tackle. And now they've come up with a third and four.
All right, well, here is your offensive answer. Your defense did the job. Now it's your offense's turn. They need 3+ yards.
Let's look for Stam running to the wide side.
Nope, they go Elvis.
That surprises me.
Sean O'Connor was there, number 52. Elvis is scary. It is intriguing.
The reason I say that is because every time that they split him out with this double slot up here, Stam has run this way, but they're coming right down in here right now. And if you're at home not getting sick from all my lines, that kind of surprises me. It's a short yardage play, but Stam has been so successful early on going off tackle out of that formation.
Here is your field position game being played. It's 4th and 2, ball at 40-yard line, not a time to take chances. Stam is the punter. This one will float. Jaworski with the fair catch at the 26.
My foot hurts just thinking of him. It's like punting a brick. Just the thud of that, my foot was tingling.
34-yard kick for Joe Stam. So we've traded defensive stops.
And they're back about where they started from, the initial start. So it's going to be one of those who bends or breaks first.
Craig Tomasino will come off the bench. He will join that unit offensively. He will send his center, Anthony Hickey, up to the line. Hickey has a slight tear of his ACL. He's had it all season long. But he is a warrior, and he will give the snap to Tomasino. He'll give it off to Jaworski. JR still on his feet. And he will go another 3 yards to the 42.
That's the power off tackle that they're noted for. Everything's going to come from the pole. It's going to be from this side. Fullback's leading, halfback's leading. Here comes the guard coming out in front of him. That's just a power off tackle. And then you leave it up to that 6'2", 215-pounder. And you can see right there, he's like a bull in a china shop. He does not come down with an arm tackle.
100 yards even for J.R. Jaworski today. To the outside goes Brad Hudis. He's got a first down.
That was a touchdown saving tackle right there because he had one man to beat. Again, because of the strength of the off tackle play allows the fullback to come right up in here, and you can see he pops it back here, and you're going to see a game saving tackle possibly right here in the open field. Just gets literally tripped up.
And a couple of 4A records in jeopardy here at midway point of the third quarter. Fewest pass attempts both teams, fewest pass yards both teams. And that hope, if you're looking for records, will stay alive as the Hilltoppers from Joliet Catholic will stay in the ground here to Gruber. Coming up on the midway point of the third quarter, in a first half that saw scores on three of the first four possessions, all of a sudden the Hilltoppers here on their second possession of this quarter starting to move the ball a little bit.
You know, I look down at that offensive line for Joliet Catholic, and if you put them in different uniforms, it could be a college offensive line.
Gruber to Jaworski. He has a hole. Powers his way across the 20, and it takes two men to bring him down. Well, you talk about the offensive line. Garland, Bo, Hickey, Garcia go 300 pounds, 250, 240, 215, and 235, but it's Jaworski that can do it as well.
He's coming back in here after they flow this way. Everybody here will be pulling, coming right around here. You can see right there. That's a bread and butter play for him inside. People start sliding to the perimeter, think he's going outside, and he turns up underneath.
For a 23-yard gain, and he will get it again. Going a little bit tougher that time. Cut down and an undercut shot by Jason Hepp.
That play, actually, that he just ran is easier to defend than the first play, because the first play, he cuts back inside and cuts back against the grain, against the flow. On that last play, he's kind of going with the flow. It's a power play, and that's actually easier to defend. I say that up in the booth here.
Strong side of the offensive line is to the left. Tomasino to keep. He'll try to get to the corner. Tomasino with the stiff arm. McCoy will run him out of bounds near the 10-yard line. Well, there's two different quarterbacks. Jason Lynch, the big guy, 6'5", 200. And then you have Tomasino, the junior, at 180 pounds. He gives you a little bit different flexibility.
All the flow of the backfield is coming in this direction, and he's going with a guard out this way. And what happens is you set that up by continuing to run those plays. You start getting everybody lulled to sleep. They start flowing and pursuing the ball, and the quarterback keeps it out around the perimeter. Nice play call.
Tomasino's run will leave him a little bit short of a first down. The sticks don't have to go anywhere because they are checking that out. Get the best look. That's how short they are from the first down. You know, I look at the officials. We talk about how miserable it is. We talk about for players, for fans. I don't know how much you can put underneath those striped shirts to keep you warm and comfortable today.
You can only layer so much.
Well, we've had games played in the state championships where there's been a sheet of ice across the field, snowing. Last year in the 60s, you get what you get when you have Thanksgiving weekend in Illinois. 5:24 to play in the third quarter. Joliet Catholic on top by six. They will look to stretch it here. About 3 inches short of a first down, the ball spotted at the nine. Now Lynch will be the quarterback. Tomasino lines up as a receiver to the left.
Pull back in either direction here. There you go.
Big horse Lynch, 6'5", 220-pounder. First down sneak. No mystery there. You go behind Hickey, Bowe, and Garcia. Now you assume Tomasino and Lynch will just flip-flop roll. It's a first down and goal for Joliet Catholic Academy.
Those are the situations when it's nice to have a line that averages 248 pounds.
This drive has covered 63 yards already. Udet's the handoff. Ankle tackle down. Nice job there with the tackle. Kenny Robertson, he's the nose guard. Not a big one. But he clogs up spaces and he holds Hudek up.
Hudek has had a rough year. He's had all kinds of injuries from an ankle sprain early in the season. And right now he's got a real bad bicep pull. And he's playing with a lot of pain. He's got a special brace on.
Second and goal. Grover, can he get to the outside? He's going down. Jack Dansart, one of the linebackers, a junior. He has really stepped up his game with the loss of Luke Maurer. 73 tackles on the year. That a tackle for a loss.
That was just great. That was just great pursuit coming in from behind to make the play. You'll see him coming. The play's coming out this way. You can see him coming in here with great penetration, great pursuit. And they make the play. That's just great hustle from an outstanding defensive front of Metamora.
Third and goal. Brzezinski split to the bottom of your screen. Tomasino, backside blitz.
Oh.
Hit as he throws, falls incomplete, and Tomasino will be slow getting up. Ryan McCoy came hard and absolutely drilled Tomasino.
That was great pressure from the backside. You'll see from the backside, they're bringing him from up here because the formations are all down here. So he's going to be looking in this direction. So we'll see him throw this way and get drilled from behind.
Well, now that sets up a very interesting situation. Fourth and goal, the ball outside the 10. Your field goal kicker, Tomasino, is 4-of-4 on field goals this year. But the wind is in his face, and the Hilltoppers will go for it, leading by six. Huge play in this game. Tomasino to keep on play action.
Screen.
Brzezinski.
Oh!
Will not go down. He is brought down for a loss on the play, a slow developing play. They were spying Brzezinski. Jack Dansert again with the stop, and the ball will go to the Redbirds.
Well, they ran a lot of people up the field in crossing routes, and then they ran the Brzezinski out over here, and all the defenders did a great job for Metamora staying home. You can see there's crossing routes at the top of the screen. It's a throwback, but great effort right here by Metamora. They've always got somebody on Zerwinski.
So the lead will remain 13-7. Redbirds, their opportunity. Alvis just cannot shake free. 17 yards and 8 carries prior to that particular carry. That goes for no gain. Andrew Damiani wraps him up. Alvis runs his hardest in the big games, but Hilltopper defensive front really doing a job on him. And the fullback, so important to this Metamora offense. It's what makes it go. And you take away the fullback, and that just puts more pressure on the quarterback Stam's shoulders.
Well, if Stam can play as well in the second half as he did in the first half, that'll be a real big plus for Metamora.
Stam on the option, flips away for one tackle. Stam just ran out of the tackle of Joe Corrin, and he makes something out of nothing.
Well, he's just a great athlete, and he's just going to fake the counter right up in here, and then he's coming. Here's the pitch man back over here, and that's just great strength.
That was Ross Brosees that had him wrapped up in the backfield, not Corrin. Brosees could not bring him down.
Well, part of that is over the offseason, Stam put on 15 more pounds than he had last year.
Metamora 3 of 7 in third down situations. They're faced with one here. This ball's fumbled. Stam falls on it, and he will fall on it and actually roll it forward about 6 inches. He will still be a little bit more than a yard short of a first down. Wow, now what do you do here? 2:09. The ball at the 25. You have an offensive unit that on the season has rushed for about 370 yards.
You got to punt it. You got to win. You want to put Joliet Catholic down in a hole. There is no way you want to give Joliet Catholic the ball here. I would be really surprised if he goes for this.
Stam is the punter. He is heading up underneath center, and now whistles will stop play.
Now, this also gives...
The timeout is called on the field. That will give us an opportunity to take a break as well. Your score with a minute 49 left to play here in the third quarter. 13-7, Joliet Catholic over Metamora. This is the IHSA Television Network. Six-point difference here in the 4A state championship game, and Metamora, no matter what they do here, forced Joliet Catholic to take a timeout on fourth down at about a yard. And it appears like they're going to go for it.
I don't know if they're going to try and draw him offside and then shift to take the penalty, a five-yard penalty, and go back. They might just look at the defense. No,
no, they're going for it. They've got, made He's one got out it. Of two. They've made two out of three. First down and more. To midfield. Stam. Into Joliet Catholic territory.
Well, you got to give Pat Ryan a lot of credit on that call, because that is the ball game right there. If he doesn't make it, he's taking an awful lot of faking with him in here, and the quarterback is coming right over in here. Give the ball to your best player, and that's Stam. You can see him coming right up in here. That's a great call, a gutsy call, because obviously if he didn't make it, that could have been ball game right there. But you know what? As we said in the pregame, they came here to win. They didn't come here just to be here and say they want to stay championship game. That call illustrates that point exactly.
Sophomore cornerback Anthony Drudris brings down Stam, but not before Stam reaches the 29-yard line. And he has it again. Jaworski there, along with Pullman. A couple of secondary men coming up to close the door. What a huge play. My goodness, with about a minute and a half to play here in the third quarter, Metamora trailing by 6. Stam on the day has rushed for 153 yards.
Well, you know, he put on 15 pounds in the offseason, and it's paying off right now with the pounding that he's taken. I've been trying to take off 15 pounds.
Here he is again. Pullman will wrestle him down. Well, they're climbing on Stam's shoulders right now. Last year in this state championship game, Joe Stam, after the Redbirds were forced to fall behind, or fell behind, Stam was forced into 3 interceptions. He was not a happy man. This year, it's a different story. He is a leader. His teammates look to him. And now all of Metamora looks to him. Well, they need 2 yards on third down.
Pat Ryan has an awful lot of confidence in him. He's a bright young man, and he's a team player.
Alvis will go nowhere. He will be about a yard short. It will bring up another fourth down. Well, 3 times Metamora has been faced with a fourth down. They have converted twice, most significant one moments ago. As we wind down here in the third quarter. Well, Jack McInerney said he wants to see the second half. We all want to see the fourth quarter. Metamora on the move. 12 minutes of football remain. We'll take a break. Be back here at Memorial Stadium after this local break. Final 12 minutes of football, if not more. Joliet Catholic 13-7 over Metamora. That was our halftime score. Key stop, stopping Joliet Catholic on a fourth down and goal from outside the 10, eventually leads to a 45-yard Joe Stamm run on fourth down, and that's what brings the Redbirds together right here outside the 20-yard line. They are faced with yet another fourth down and two. And the brain trust for Joliet Catholic Academy. Corey McLaughlin, defensive coordinator Dan Sharp, along with Gordy Gillespie, pondering the state of affairs. Last year at this time, they were kind of kicking back.
They were laid back at this time last year, trying to figure out who the subs are going to be putting in the game and kind of looking to the off season. Metamora, as they said in the beginning, they came back with a mission this year. They were not going to be satisfied to be here. They wanted to be here and be a winner after the ball game, and they certainly are on that mission right now. They are proving.
Fourth down and two. Stamm to keep. He's got it and more. He's gone. This game is tied. Only fitting that number 12, Joe Stamm, punches that one in.
Well, he uses the fullback right here to seal inside. He fakes to him and comes around right outside him and uses the fullback as the blocker. Great effort right there by Stamm. Joe Stamm, a man on a mission, and he has certainly been the key for Metamora today.
13-13, Anthony Elcher, the state record holder in point after touchdowns with the attempt. And the lead for the Redbirds. The first play of the third quarter. Joliet Catholic took the kickoff, went nowhere. Pat Ryan got his stop, and now he's got the lead on the first play of the fourth quarter. 13-7, that lead gone. It's now a 14-13 Metamora lead. This is the IHSA Television Network. Three state champions were crowned yesterday, and in many observers' opinions, none of the three games were that thrilling entering the fourth quarter. Not the case here today. There is your score. We're 5 seconds in to period number four.
I feel guilty that I got a pass to come in here. I would have paid to see this.
Elger with the kickoff. Jaworski from the 18. Jaworski across the 35. He will get to the 40, and that's where the Hilltoppers will start their first possession of this fourth quarter. Daryl Burnett is standing by right now with the record holder, Lee Sosinski from Joliet Catholic.
Thanks a lot, Dave. I'm with Lee Sosinski, who's now a redshirt freshman here at the University of Illinois. You set the all-time state record with 18 tackles in this very game against Metamora last year. What are your memories of that game, Lee?
Oh, it was a great game. It was a great game for myself and the whole team and the community of Joliet. And, you know, hopefully we can get another repeat here today.
It was 48-13 last year, a much different game we're seeing here today.
Much different game. You know, Metamora came out to play today, and I've got to give them a lot of respect. And, you know, we'll see what happens. We're down by point now, but we're not going to give up.
Good luck at the U of I. Let's go back up top.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Daryl. Thanks, Lee. J.R. Zwarzynski with that first carry brought down by Andy Reuter. The wind is at the back of Joliet Catholic, though if you take a look at the United States flag atop the scoreboard here, Memorial Stadium, it is wrapped around the pole. So the wind is definitely swirling here. Once again, Zwarzynski tries to go behind Garcia and Hudes. The Redbird defense will have none of that. Nick Panair, number 8, strung it out along with John Schlemmer.
Well, kind of an interesting stat, Dave, is in the fourth quarters, Metamora's only given up 26 points. Here goes Zawinski out here, and just tremendous pursuit coming from the backside, from the linebackers and the defensive line. And as I mentioned, in the fourth quarter, that's been the lowest scoring quarter against Metamora. Their defense has come up big in the fourth quarter. Let's see if they do it today.
Joliet Catholic, 4 of 8 on third down conversions. They need 11 yards. They get to Bruver, and he should have it.
Big play.
Third down and 11. Gruber got about 11 and a half. It's a first down. The drive will stay alive.
Well, again, they're showing flow this way, and then they come back with Gruber inside, and this is the key to misdirection.
and you get a fast flow and you get angles. That's the big thing. You get angles for the offensive lineman up front, and they're taking advantage of it. That was a big, big run.
Now into Metamora territory. Fullback Hudex across inside the 40. He is close to yet another first down.
They're doing a real nice job of mixing up the calls here. They're going off tackle, and they're popping the fullback up inside, and they're keeping Metamora off balance.
Brad Hudetz, close enough for a measurement. Senior, 180 pounds. While we have this measurement, let's give you another shot at winning yourself an IHSA state cap. Here's your question. These two teams combined for the most points in a 4A title game. Now what we need you to do is name the team and the number of points scored. And how do you do it? Right there. TV at IHSA.org. So get on, let us know. TV at IHSA.org. First one in, we've got a cap coming your way. First down for Hudetz. The ball at the 38 of Metamora. Joliet Catholic trailing by a point. Brzezinski. The yards a little bit harder to come by now from a fired up Metamora defense.
You know, we talked about in the beginning of the game the size of the offense and defensive lines, and right now Metamora is coming up big with their defensive line. These guys right down here are making the plays. The guards pulling out, and they're just holding their ground and doing a great job of not being driven off the ball and making the plays.
Only a couple of yards there for Brzezinski. Gruber. They've run that play one too many times. John Mischler. As we said, he did not get to play in a state championship game last year, and he's making up for it here in 2000.
Again, misdirection, trying to come back, and they're faking in this way and coming back in through here. But great penetration right in here, and that makes the big difference. When you get penetration on misdirection, you either go under the penetration, but in this case, they stayed flat on the line of scrimmage and made the big play.
A broken leg in the quarterfinals left last year kept Mitchler off the field. It's third down and nine. Tomasino.
Wide open.
Lynch. Ooh. This one's intercepted by Panair. The first turnover of the game on the first pass attempt by Craig Tomasino. And Metamora will take over with 8:41 to play in a one-point lead.
He was open deep going on a post route, and if he would have got the ball up, we're going to come right here, and he's going to go right up the middle of the field, and we just underthrow it, and you can see right here the safety comes underneath and makes the play. Had he gotten the ball up there sooner, he might have had six, but might have, could have, should have, would have. It's still 13-14 right here. Metamora up on top. That's a big play for him.
Redbirds will have to hurry out of this huddle. The play clock is already down to 6 seconds.
They don't need a penalty here.
Play clock at two. And they did not get it off.
They're just not used to looking at those clocks in the end zone. And Coach Ryan's a little upset. He's pointing to the end zone.
Dead ball.
Look at the clock.
Delay of game on the offense. Field first down.
Well, Stan was one of the players, about four players, that came off the sideline. Got some last-minute words. And it was that 15-second delay or so there that kept things a problem for Metamora. There are your penalties. Only five penalties on the day. Remember that key one, though, earlier in the game that wiped out a 39-yard touchdown run by Stam. He will keep it. He gets a block. Stam will stretch it to the 20. Mike Pullman with the tackle.
The other part of that is that they need to get out of there a little bit to punt, because they're going to be punting into a very strong, swirling wind, and they do not want to give Joliet Catholic the ball at midfield. So they want to at least sustain some sort of a drive, that if it does falter, it's going to be more at midfield where they could punt them down into their own territory.
Second and seven.
Look how tight that fullback is.
Ferguson. A yard and maybe less, and now a fumble. That's what the Hilltoppers say, and that's what the officials say. An exchange of turnovers will put the ball at the 20.
Well, they're coming back with a counter right up in here, and he loses the football right on the hit. Right there, it's on the ground. You can see Joliet Catholic jumping on the football. That's a big turnover.
We'll see how big Metamora comes up now with a stop.
Gordy Gillespie and Dan Sharp have been in numerous situations like this. 8 minutes to play in the 4A state championship game. They have 8 state championships under their belt. It's a state record. Lynch with the pitch to Zorzinski. Can he get to the corner? Brought down just as he was ready to make that plant.
There was a great block, a crackback block that sprung him. Watch the outside, and you'll see the crackback block coming in. It springs him. It's going to be up here at the top of the screen. We can't see it yet, but it's coming right back there, right there. Gets him to the outside, and he's able to make the turn. Now he tries to turn up, and this is where he slips right here. Nice shoestring tackle, but Joliet Catholic right now is in the driver's seat.
Slimmer with the tackle. Second and a couple. The cut, the first down. Zorzinski inside the five. First and goal from there.
That could have been a big, big play in the backfield there. Bittner had him for a 4-yard loss. Watch the play right up in here. Right there. He's got him, misses him. And look at the result of that miss. From a 4-yard loss to about a 12-yard gain, puts him on the 2-yard line. Big play.
Joliet Catholic trailing by a point from the 2-yard line. Korzinski hammered down. There's some big-time hitting going on now. Number two is part of it. There's a few guys in some red jerseys that have something to say about it as well. He loses a yard.
Oftentimes when you see where he is, you slant away from where he is because he's going to be going the opposite way. So if he's on the right wing, you'll slant to the left because that's where he's going to be coming to, and that's what happened on that last play.
Second down, goal, 3-yard line. Go behind the right side. Gruber, the lead. Joliet Catholic with 6:18 to play in the 4A state championship goes on top by 5, 19-14. Grubert's second touchdown run of the day.
Again, now this is going away from, we're coming over to this side of the field, away from Wierzynski, and he throws a nice block right here, and you run in behind that big offensive line, and 2 yards to gain is not too tough. Right there, you get a kick out block, 6 points.
Now the 5-point difference, now the 2-point conversion.
Now this is normally where they run, right up in here for their power, so we'll see if they do that.
Korzynski has 12 2-point conversions on the year. Gruber with the carry. Gruber will not get it. We have a 5-point gain. J.R. Korzynski with 24 2-point conversions in the course of 2 years, but Gruber gets the call.
Well, we run right at the power where they put the wing back. This is something where they say, here, we're going here, you try and stop us. And most teams are not capable of stopping them. With that big offensive line and the hard running backs, it's tough to stop them when you're only 2 yards out.
So a touchdown by Metamora here would give the Redbirds the lead, but the Hilltoppers answer. Taking advantage of a fumble forced by Ross Proces, they go 20 yards in 4 plays, only use a minute 42 off the scoreboard clock.
Well, a key to this now, Dave, will be the run back here, field position off of this kick. It'll be real interesting to see where they get the ball. If they can get it to midfield, Metamora will be in good shape because they have been running the ball fairly well against Joliet Catholic. So the key will be to get the ball, to return on this.
Longest winning streak in the state at 27 games. And how about this for history? 15th time a Joliet Catholic team has been unbeaten, untied in a year. But that's bottom one, Jack. That is absolutely amazing for anybody that's involved in any kind of athletics at the high school level. 41 consecutive winning seasons.
That's a tremendous tradition.
A short kick to the 17.
Panera
with it.
Ooh, if he would have cut back.
He stays up and finally brought down. When you are high atop Memorial Stadium, you can see those holes, and there it was. You said there was a wall. There was a hole in that wall as well.
If he would have cut back one step, easy to say from up here, but he had a wall. He did a nice job, and he cut back. Six minutes, 65 yards. They're capable of doing it, obviously.
This copyrighted broadcast is presented for the entertainment and non-commercial use of our audience. Any reproduction or other use of this program without the express written consent of the Illinois High School Association is strictly prohibited. And Joe Stan will get about three.
Again, they didn't take the pitch, man. They doubled up on Stam, and if he's able to get that pitch off, there's an awful lot of running room for that halfback. And again, if the coaches spot that, he'll be pitching the ball.
They ran away from Pat McShane's side of the defensive line and right into the arms of Mike Kolodziej. And now they better hurry as again in this huddle. The play clock down to 10 seconds. Schlemmer brought the play in. He will split to the bottom of your screen. They better hurry. Clock is at 4. They get it off just in time. Alvis will power his way across the 40-yard line. He will be about 4 yards short of the first down. Here was your trivia question for the second half. These two teams combined for the most points in a 4A title game. Now, tough question. Name the teams. Name the number of points. Geneseo, Darnell, Springfield Griffin, 44-36, 80 points. But here's the astounding part. We are reaching California. The winner, Mike Koop, from Mountain View, California, Joliet Catholic, class of 86. So the internet bringing you this 4A state championship game worldwide. And the world will see another fourth down situation coming up here for the Metamora Redbirds.
If Pat Ryan didn't have gray hair before this game started, he's going to have it by the time the game's over. He's had about four or five big fourth down decisions to make.
Three of those four times, they have been successful decisions, the last two of which led to a Metamora lead, a 45-yard run from Stam and a touchdown run from Stam. Now they need a long 4 yards on fourth down. Will he throw? Can he get to the outside? A flag is down. Stam tripped up as well. Jaworski with the ankle tackle. But a flag at the 40.
Probably going to be holding from where that flag was thrown.
And Joliet Catholic would decline it. We will get the call.
Holding.
4 minutes and 16 seconds left. Stam tried to do it.
Well, they have the flankers out there. It looks like they want to throw it, but he's got tremendous penetration, so it's a total breakdown of the pocket. And of course, his strength is his scrambling ability, but he just gets tripped up right there. And that unfortunately could be the ball game unless we have a turnover right here.
4 minutes and 16 seconds separate the players in the white jerseys, Joliet Catholic Academy, from their second straight state championship, their ninth overall, and that would add to their record. Tomasino, the quarterback, gives to the fullback Hudetz for a couple.
Well, you know, you say, well, it's kind of early to say with 4 minutes left, but Joliet Catholic strength is their running game, so obviously they're going to run the clock, the time, and the yardage, and Metamora might have seen the ball for the last time in this ball game.
19-14. That's the Hilltopper lead.
The first guy makes the tackle, the second guy rips for the ball. Try to get a turnover.
Remember, the field is wet. Still a mist in the air. Swierczynski takes the hit. Gets inside the 35. Now, Metamora has three timeouts to use. Do they choose to use one here on third down?
They've taken a timeout.
Timeout, Metamora.
Indeed, they do. It would be third down and 6. And they come back from this timeout. 3:41 to play in the game. Tomasino to the sidelines. His quarterback coach is the man in the stocking cap. That's the legendary Gordy Gillespie. He is a calming influence on his quarterbacks. He's a calming influence on anybody.
And you're a calming influence on me. There's so much in common that we have around here. It's amazing. But you know, it's really interesting when you look at Joliet Catholic, you say, you know, calming influence. Here's a school that has been in the state championship game 11 times. Now, granted, these kids on the field weren't involved in this all those years, but you know what? They're brothers, uncles. It's a family tradition, and you know, that goes on in the community. And these kids want to be here. They expect to be here. So they like this kind of pressure. And of course, Gordy Gillespie is the one that started all that many, many years ago.
On the near side of the field, we get a look at number 12, Joe Stam. His team has been here for the last 5 years. second place on three of those occasions. Here's a third and six. Here's Wierzynski. Can he get to the corner? He has got the first down. Yes. You had to wait for the bar official to come running up that sideline. And according to his spot, it's a first down. And more time will leave the clock.
Well, it's a combination. They're coming this way, and they end up going back outside with the reverse. Right here, he hands it off inside counter. And he just bounces it out. It wasn't designed to go outside, but his athleticism takes him out there. And he picks up that first down by about a yard. And now Joliet Catholic again has got ball control from about the 27-yard line.
Kudets. They'll be just looking for him to wrap it up. How about the exchange of turnovers moments ago? Down by a few points, by a point. An interception by Nick Panair from Metamora stopped a Joliet Catholic potential scoring drive, and then they gave it right back. Ferguson, a fumble forced by Ross Broces, led to the go-ahead score from Joliet Catholic. Second down and six. Swierczynski pushes Garcia, his offensive guard, in front of him. He will be about 3 yards short of the first down. And Pat Ryan wants another timeout. Right now, he says, with 2:53 to play, that is their second timeout. The Redbirds from Metamora will have one left.
I certainly hope Gruber and Zerwinski have taken Carlos Garcia and Steve Bowe out for dinner several times during this season, because both those guards have done a great job of pulling out in front of them on the power plays and making some great blocks. There's a good shot right there, number 66, Steve Douglas. His dad is the offensive line coach, Dave Douglas, and he's a big kid at 235, 6'3", and he's only a sophomore.
In fact, Douglas was not even going to be on the varsity at the beginning of the year. Some other injuries on the offensive front for Joliet Catholic necessitated Dan Sharp to reach down and grab Douglas off that sophomore team. Pretty good pick.
Not a bad choice.
We said Joliet Catholic bidding to become the first team to win 9 state championships. As far as Metamora is concerned, they have fallen to Providence in 96 and 97 in the state championship game. And now, Joliet Catholic last year, unless something in a real positive way happens for the Redbirds, they're 2 minutes and 53 seconds away from yet another second place trophy, but so much more to go here in the 4A championship. It's a third down, we'll call it 3 yards. Quarterback is Lynch. Gruber pushes, forces, that offensive line surges, and is it enough?
They got a good mark. They got a pretty good mark. We'll probably see a measurement on this. Nope, they're giving up to him.
It is a first down with 2:46 to play. Garland, Bowe, Hickey, Garcia, and Douglas, the men up front.
You got to give Pat Ryan a lot of credit to come back here a second year in a row after really having been shocked last year by Joliet Catholic and to come down to the wire against Joliet Catholic. Ryan has done a super, super job.
Flags come out, whistles. Play clock still had time left. This could be a procedure call. It is. Pat Ryan's response to coming down to the state championship game again, he said, well, we got what we wanted. That's the good news. The bad news is Joliet Catholic. I'll tell you something, Pat. The good news is your guys have been not only just here all day, they have led.
Big
and been a force.
Ball start on the offense.
It's been an outstanding ball game. Two heavyweights just going toe-to-toe and pounding on each other till the 15th round and nobody's hit the deck. It's going to be a decision, right? What do they call that, a technical decision or whatever? It's too bad you can't have a draw in football. Two teams, both 13-0, great programs, great seasons.
Lynch to keep it. He will make sure he stays in bounds, struggles up to the 16-yard line. He had thoughts of getting to the outside. Said, no, that's not where I want to be. Anthony Elger, number 93 on the sidelines, and he is talking to our country company's player of the game. Today's Player of the Game is brought to you by Country Companies Insurance. Real people, real answers, real quick. Joe Stamm. real quick today.
Well, you know, that stat, normally you look at that stat, and if you didn't know better, you'd say he was the tailback. You wouldn't expect those kind of stats for a quarterback.
Korzynski, short of the first down. It will be third down again. We have a minute 20 left, and this is where the Redbirds from Metamora will take their final timeout. 1:21 to play.
Timeout.
So now you bring the teams over.
That's Metamora's
here. Metamora, you go out to them. Dan Sharp has the Hilltoppers clustered about him. We had three games yesterday here in the IHSA television network. 1A, 2A, and 3A. You've had a beauty here in Class 4A. Oh, but there's more to come. At 3 o'clock this afternoon, make sure you come right back here. What a matchup the 5A championship is. Two great rivals. Providence Catholic out of New Lenox and against Mount Carmel out of the city of Chicago. That is your 5A championship game at 3 o'clock. And then at 7 o'clock, a couple of teams that quite frankly nobody expected to be here, but they're playing for a state championship. Maine South and Glenbard North, that is your 6A championship, and that is right here as well at 7 a.m. So just warm up the hot chocolate inside and settle down with us. If we can get two more games like this one, the people here should come back and pay again. It is third down and six. Korzynski, big hole up the middle. He's going in. And that run should bring the ninth state football championship back home to Joliet. It's an 11-point Hilltopper lead.
It's just an inside trap coming right up inside. You can see it's just a counter right up in here behind that guard, and he turns it up inside. They were playing the perimeter a little more. Good call up inside. You wanted to keep the ball on the ground. You wanted to stay in between the hash marks. Nothing better than running a trap up inside, and the only better result is a touchdown, and that's what they picked up. Great call. Great job by the offensive line.
Korzynski's 33rd touchdown of the season, his second in this year's state championship game. Looking for two, an 11-point lead, and they did not get the playoff. It's 25-14. Play clock had run down. So that may
dead
change
ball,
the play call here.
Real game against the offensive team. We'll replay the try.
This has really been an extremely well-played football game from the standpoint of execution, from fundamentals. Two outstanding programs, two teams extremely well coached. And from a coaching standpoint, just watching the offense and defensive line, the execution has been outstanding. From a coaching standpoint, my hat is certainly off to both coaching staffs of these schools. The kids have done a great, great job.
A long two-point conversion here coming up for Joliet Catholic. Korzynski
going to throw it.
Has McShane open on the end zone. Instead, he goes to Lynch for the two-point conversion.
It's man-to-man coverage down there, and nobody is responsible for the quarterback, and he just blows out, and everybody rotates, and they didn't pick up the quarterback. It's just a throwback. It's not an uncommon play, but it certainly works well right down here. He's going to come back outside, but full flow this way. Nobody takes the quarterback. They're all flowing in the direction of Zerwinski, and there he is, wide open. Quarterback throwback, two-point conversion.
Kind of helps when your quarterback spends most of his time at a receiver position. Makes that play a little bit easier. And actually, Korzynski had his choice of either McShane or Lynch.
Well, coming into the game, Zerwinski was 3 for 6 for 53 yards and two touchdowns. Not a bad average.
27-14, your score. We have ourselves a new 4A record. 96 rush attempts, two teams combined. 96 times, that breaks the previous record of 41. That involved the same Joliet Catholic team back with Geneseo Darnell. 47 rushes for Darnell, 44 for Joliet Catholic. And now Jaworski will have to hold that ball on a tee back in the 40. That's pretty simple right now. If you're Metamora, you need a run back. And they've been close on a couple of occasions today. And this is the wise move by Joliet Catholic.
for the fans at home, you know, you can call for a fair catch on a kickoff, so they could have called for a fair catch and taken the ball right there, but obviously they wanted to run back and get better field position.
Gordy Gillespie, 5 state championships in his pocket. He got it all started at Joliet Catholic Academy. He's an assistant coach. He's a baseball coach at Ripon College in Wisconsin. Gordy will come down on day games, on the days of games, but he will be in constant touch with head coach Dan Sharp by way of fax, phone, and whatever other message service he can employ. He has a major impact not only on this year's team, but the Joliet Catholic Academy family. Stamp must throw. Schertz unable to hang on. 1:10 to play in this 4A championship.
Well, that's the kind of pass that's not going to get him a lot of yards because it's just a flare pass to the halfback. He catches it, he's out of bounds, and the linebackers are going to keep the ball in front of him as well as the secondary, so they're not going to give up any long scores. They're going to let Metamora throw the ball if they want to. They're just not going to let him throw deep.
Only one wideout, that's Schlemmer at the very bottom of your screen.
Well, the linebacker dropping out of there.
Pat McShane, we spotlighted him in the pregame. Great speed. Assistant coach from Michigan State University has said that Pat McShane, his quickness off the ball is among the top 5 in the nation in high school seniors.
Well, you'll see great penetration by McShane. He's only 215 pounds, and he's coming right from the backside. But as a player at Boston College, he'll be a stand-up linebacker. But he has great speed. He has 15 sacks during the season.
Third down and long. Stamp.
Wow.
Takes the hit. He will be just short of the first down. But there is no way that you could have expected him to get what he did there.
That was a great effort right there.
26 seconds to play in this championship game.
For as much as he was disappointed last year with his performance in the game, even though it's a losing cause this year, he has certainly done a tremendous job this year.
But a clipping call will bring this back and, in effect, delay the inevitable. Metamora marching through the Mid-Illini Conference, their 6th conference championship in as many years, have made a habit of being in the state championship game. Almost incredibly, 4 times in the last 5 years. Think about that for a second. Not only do you have to have a great year, you have to work your way through the playoffs. Pat Ryan said this year's playoff run for the Redbirds, the toughest they have been through in any of those 5 appearances down here.
Against the offense.
You know, the competition from 4A, 5A, and 6A, it really is, you just throw them all in a hat because they all can compete. They're all fairly good-sized schools, but the key is that they're so big and fast. I mean, these kids at the 4A level, like right here, you look at Joliet Catholic, and they could be playing a 6A game. I mean, they're bigger than the teams that are playing in the 6A game. So nowadays, these teams that get to the state championship game, they all have special teams and with a lot of size.
Stam to McCoy, and it won't matter. The clock winds down, and Joliet Catholic Academy, for the 2nd year in succession, will claim the Class 4A title at the expense of the Metamora Redbirds.
They put up a heck of a battle.
Oh, boy, boy.
Heck of a football game.
Many people coming down here today were either hoping or maybe expecting. Hoping if they were Joliet Catholic, expecting if they were Joliet Catholic fans, to have the type of game they had last year, a 48-13 win over Metamora. The Redbird fans had other ideas, and indeed, until a late score, they had things going their way. A game played in weather that you would not want to stand outside led to records. Fewest pass attempts, both teams. Previously was 15, Wheaton North, LaSalle, Peru, and also Providence and Metamora back in 96. There's a new record. It is 7 set today. This is the IHSA Television Network. More after this.
7:14, the final. Joliet Catholic has done it once again. And Coach, it's raining out here. It's cold, but where you're standing, the sun is shining.
Oh, it certainly is. I think it's shining all of Joliet today. It was a great, great game. My hat's off to Pat Ryan and his staff. What a tremendous football team they have. We knew this was going to be one of the toughest final games down here in the tournament, and they are the class act. I certainly hope he deserves to win one more than anyone else, and I'm rooting for him as long as he's not playing Joliet Catholic. So, but I think they have a tremendous club, and Stam is a great quarterback. But our kids came through in tough situations. You know, our game plan gets cut down to about one quarter of what you think you want to do going a day like today, but they responded and played excellent football.
We can talk all about touchdowns, but I really thought the key was with 4:16 left in the game, you stopped them on fourth down.
That was the key. It was a great play. Their quarterback stands and making plays all day, and our kids came up with a big play to stop them. Credit defensive staff and our defensive kids who play hard all the time.
So many stars, but talk about JR and Gruber. They really did the job and stepped up when they had to for you today.
Well, they have all year, you know. JR and Gruber are two outstanding running backs, and they got seven excellent blockers in front of them. Our quarterbacks do a good job on the offense, but again, last week we ended the game with JR running a counter for a touchdown, so he decided to do it again this week. It was a great run.
Dan, congratulations. You have some hardware to go pick up. We'll let you get back to the trophy stand.
Thank you very much. You guys do a wonderful job running this tournament. It's really an honor to be here, and thanks to the IHSA and Illinois for a wonderful job.
Thank you, Dan. Let's go back out to the booth now.
Thank you very much, Darrell. And you took a look at Dan Sharp. He's going to get spoiled. The head coach of Joliet Catholic for 4 years. He's won a state championship in each of the last 2 years. Four Hilltopper head coaches have won championships. Gordy Gillespie has won five. Jim Boyder and Bob Stone each won one. And Dan Sharp here gets this one today. But you look back at Metamora, and you try to get a sense of what their emotions would be. Pat Ryan said, you know, if we can go to the last game with good kids and play 14 games, I'll take it. But would I trade 4 seconds for a first? He left that question unanswered.
Well, unfortunately, part of that answer he got today. He brought those kids to this game. They played their heart and soul out right up until the last 3 minutes. The game was on the line, and the turnover changed the direction of the ball game. But his kids certainly played extremely well. They deserved to be state champions. They fell a little short. He cannot question the effort he got from his kids. And, you know, you're looking at a very powerful Joliet Catholic team, and Metamora game all they could handle.
That is history right there, folks. At least history for maybe another 3 or 4 hours. Mount Carmel will have an opportunity to tie that record, 9 state titles, 75, 76, 77, 78, and 81 were Gordy Gillespie years. Of course, in 81 and 87, it was 5A. Otherwise, this 4A class has been dominated by the Hilltoppers from Joliet Catholic Academy. Now, coming up in the game at 3 o'clock, we say Mount Carmel, they may have something to say about that. They will be in action right here against Providence Catholic. Talk about story traditions in that one. We've gotten ourselves off to a pretty good start here today, as you see the Hilltoppers. Obviously, a very relieved bunch. They came in with the pressure on them all season to repeat. And then when the brackets came out, Metamora and Joliet Catholic are in opposite ends, but it's the Hilltoppers dressed in white for the second year in a row that we'll get to put that trophy over their heads.
I say in the back of his mind, Pat Ryan really was excited when he saw that bracket pairing, because I feel, knowing Pat Ryan, that he, the kind of competitor he is, he wanted to get another shot at Joliet Catholic. So he was thrilled to see that they were in opposite brackets and could possibly meet in the state championship game. That's the kind of coach he is. And you could tell that by all the fourth down situations that he went for in their own territory. He came here to win. He had a competitive team. He's competitive by nature. His kids gave Joliet Catholic all he could handle. It's very disappointing to watch them walk off the field with that second place trophy, but they certainly laid their heart and their effort on the field tonight.
The final statistics are in on this one. Joliet Catholic minus 6 yards passing. Guess what? It does not matter. 308 total yards, of which 314 came on the ground. And actually, when you take a look at those numbers, Jack, they almost seem a little bit more unbalanced than I would have even expected. The game seemed closer yardage-wise even than those numbers indicate.
Well, actually, the yardage came more in the last 4 minutes. Now, you take away some big yardage by Metamora. They had a couple of big plays, that long touchdown call back in the first quarter, and a couple other big runs that Stam made called back. That would be almost even. Time of possession was kind of interesting. close ball game.
You talked about Metamora as they exit the field to our left down below. You take a look at the Hilltoppers right there. But Metamora last year left this stadium, quite frankly, in Pat Ryan's words, embarrassed, almost humiliated in terms of losing to Joliet Catholic 48-13. Now they walk off disappointed. They will go in their locker rooms. There will be the tears shed because this team will be breaking apart. But I know it's a cliche. We always say when you look back at it, they will realize how close they were here today and what a great team they had. This was the year that Pat Ryan thought that they had a chance to do something. Last year snuck up on them a little bit. This year was not to be. But for those guys, it was.
They're going to have to knock out another wall over at the high school and start putting in all that hardware that they're picking up. But you know what? The sun will always come up the next day. These kids right now are young and depressed at this moment, 16, 17-year-old kids, and all of a sudden they'll realize that this was a tremendous experience for them, and tomorrow when they get up, they'll feel a lot different. I mean, they won't obviously, they'll still be dejected they lost the ball game, but they'll realize that they were part of history.
Joliet Catholic fans, you saw them there just above the Hilltopper fans. Well, they were hiding up underneath the upper deck here with the weather elements. As the game wore on, they filtered more and more down to the side of the field, and that's where the Hilltoppers were saluting their fans just moments ago. Well, we talked about J.R. Zwierzynski, his running mate, his best friend, Chris Gruber, standing by right now with Daryl Burnett.
Thanks a lot, Dave. Chris, you know, really the score doesn't indicate how tough that game was. You had the go-ahead touchdown. Tell us about how it unfolded for you.
Well, it was a 29-buck, and the left side sealed it off really good, and both kicked the guy out, and I just tried to get it in, and I did.
So many championships, so much tradition at this school. What does this one mean to you as a junior?
Oh, it means a lot to me. You know, this is my first shot at a state title ever, so this feels sweet.
What is it like to be running side by side with JR? What a tremendous talent he is. What a tremendous talent you are.
Oh, yeah, we work really good together. I mean, we're best friends, and we feed off each other.
The question you're going to get soon is, can you do it again next year?
Well, we're going to work hard in the offseason, and we're going to give it another shot next year.
Go enjoy this one. Great day, even though the rain was here. Tremendous championship, tremendous effort for you.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, let's go back upstairs.
Thank you very much, Daryl. We talk about Warriors. That was the guy right there, Daryl Burnett, on the sidelines today. We would like to remind our local affiliates that we will be sending it back to you a little bit sooner than you may have anticipated. But as the Hilltoppers exit the field, Pat McShane will leave the field. We'll take a look back at some of the key plays in this particular game. Of course, the Hilltoppers, when you give it to JR, you know you've got a key play.
Well, when you have size that he has, 215 pounds, and the speed and power, you know you're going to get some big plays. And, of course, on the other side of the ball, with Stam and his running ability and putting on those 15 pounds, coming up with some speed and power, he was the difference today. He kept Metamora in the ball game. Alvis did not have the kind of game that he's had all season, so that put twice as much pressure on Stam, but you know what? He came through like a true trooper and a champion. He came up with big plays time after time in the entire ball game, and of course, this is the big touchdown that put him up on top.
On the other side, Craig Tomasino.
Boy, we didn't see that all day. That's that big pick. They throw it once, they get it picked off. That was that drive that they had going right after Metamora scored, and they stopped him. And then, of course, here's the big fumble. This is the turnaround right here. And this happens in high school football. Unfortunately, it happened there. And then right here, of course, is the last nail in the coffin, the touchdown by Gruber.
Here's for good measure, J.R. Zwierzynski will put the final points on the board. High steps his way into the end zone with his 33rd touchdown of the season. A very calm-looking bunch of Hilltoppers going into their locker room. But they're a happy bunch as well. There is your final score in the 4A State Football Championship. Joliet Catholic Academy, twice in a row over the Metamora Redbirds this year, here in the year 2000, 27-14 for their ninth state football championship. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Now, a reminder, we are not done here today. 3 o'clock kickoff, 5A championship game, and then back at Memorial Stadium at 7 p.m. We hope you've enjoyed it, and until then, so long now.